many, many treaties that work quite well. Somehow the mail is delivered in Moscow from me, and we get their mail, and all planes land safely because we have international standards, and you buy aspirin in the Soviet Union or even in Peking, and it has the same pharmaceutical formula. So we have any number of ways that we can collaborate when it is important to both sides. Well, nuclear arms control is important to both sides. Some people say, but we can't trust the Russians. You can trust the Russians to do what is good for the Russians. And they know that it is very good for them to have bilateral, mutual freeze so that they don't have to spend vast sums of their resources to now have Star Wars where they fear that we'll go.
Robert F. Drinan is professor of law at Georgetown University. Previously, he was a five-term member of the House of Representatives and Dean of the Boston College Law School. Father Drinan is the author of Beyond a Nuclear Freeze, Vietnam and Armageddon, and Democracy, Dissent, and Disorder. Today, Father Drinan shares some of his central insights into the quest for peace.
Father Drinan, you've commented that there's no problem facing mankind more urgent than that of the nuclear threat.
I think that's just so self-evident. The Catholic bishops have said it recently, but we've been saying that for at least 40 years. I teach a course on arms control and disarmament at Georgetown University Law Center, and each year the students come upon that realization, and I hope that it changes their life. I think this is the number one issue in American politics, and I think that a person who comes along and says the right things to deepen the anxiety of American people, he might, you know, she might become president.
You have said that arms control is an urgent problem, but it's been more than 10 years since there's been a major arms control agreement that was signed and ratified.
But I do think that the SALT process has been very important. That the it was Nixon that negotiated SALT 1, banning the anti-ballistic missile, and that was ratified. And Jimmy Carter signed SALT 2, and it would have been ratified probably except for Afghanistan.
As you have reflected on the fact that we now have to deal with the Russians, there's no divorce possible. You've called for greater understanding. What do people need to know about the Russians?
Well, we need to know a lot, and they need to know a lot about us. And that it seems to me it's very counterproductive when the President of the United States says that is the evil empire. I never thought, frankly, that we'd be harking back to the 50s, the beginning of the Cold War. I've been to the Soviet Union. I think we ought to have lots of students over there, a lot of students from the Soviet Union here, as we're doing now with China. And I think that we ought to de-escalate the rhetoric. I like church groups going to the Soviet Union. The moment that you begin to say things like this, especially if you're in political life, they say, oh, he's soft on communists. And that it is popular for some politicians to say that they're barbarians, they'll take anything that they want to. And the late Senator Jackson, Scoop Jackson, for example, used to say that the Soviets are like a person walking down a hotel room, and that this person would go into any room that is open and take everything there. And I think that's wrong. That's a mischaracterization. They obviously have a lot of fear of us. They feel surrounded. They lost at least 30 million people in World War II, and they insist upon holding the satellites because they're afraid once again that they will be invaded, as they have been going back to at least Napoleon. They have these terrible fears of encroachment from the other side, and as a result, they keep at least a million soldiers along the borders of Manchuria. I think we ought to understand all of that and keep talking to them. And that was done under détente, and I think that President Ford deserves some credit for signing Helsinki on August 1st, 1975. The Soviets have not complied with the Helsinki in every respect, but I've been at the deliberations of the 35 Helsinki nations at Madrid and elsewhere, and I think it's a great process and that we should go forward with it.
The American people form many of their ideas about citizenship as part of going through formal education. The peace issue has not been a central part of the curriculum. What do you want educators to do differently, part of this issue?
Well, in the pastoral of the Catholic bishops, they went out of their way to say that all schools, especially Catholic schools, should have full-blown courses on peace. I think that at the Catholic college level, several courses on peace have grown up. I think the kids are deeply interested in it.
You've put together a course yourself on arms control. What's in it? What have you want people to learn so that they can exercise their role in this democracy more effectively?
Well, we try to stress the legal and the public policy issues, obviously, because these kids are virtually lawyers, and that they have to write major papers, and they write papers which sometimes are rather specialized, at least for the ordinary peace-loving person. One of the papers this year, for example, will be on the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency. And in 1961, Hubert Humphrey said, "We have no agency in American life that gives us accurate information about arms control." So the Congress invented this ACDA, Arms Control and Disarmament Agency. It's supposed to be outside the ambit of the State Department and the Executive and also the Pentagon, operating as a fact-finding institution. Why hasn't it been more successful? That's one paper.
You have a great faith in the rule of law, but the world order is essentially an anarchy. There, Adlai Stevenson, you quoted that the United States needs to decide once and for all whether we intend to be multilateral. What do we need to do to affect the rule of law more effectively?
Well, that's something to which I've given most of my adult life, frankly. I am presently the chairman of the Standing Committee on World Order Under Law of the American Bar Association. This is a conservative group, but I like to think that this standing committee effectively teaches the ABA something about arms control. We have had resolutions go through the governing board of the American Bar Association which have been helpful. It's a very, very tough problem that you pose. All I know is that way back in 1961, under Eisenhower or Kennedy, the United Nations General Assembly proposed a resolution which we agreed to, that we would get rid of all nuclear weapons. This was the dream at that time. And if we have to fault anybody, I'm afraid we have to fault the United States for not going forward with the rule of law and for boycotting the United Nations and not even going back to the Baruch Plan. We knew in 1947 that all of this was a nightmare. And under the Baruch Plan, the United States proposed for the first time that we take all fissionable material and all existing bombs and put them into some international archive or treasury. That was not agreed to, perhaps because of the USSR, perhaps because of us. In any event, we have to go back to some form of the Baruch Plan so that we have international control.
The Church has for centuries spoken out about war, its role in society. There's been a theory of just war. You question whether a just war is possible anymore in a nuclear age.
Well, I do, and I wrote a book about that. However, if there is any just war, I would think that it could be the revolution of the Sandinistas against Somoza. That is a clear revolution against unjust government, and I'm not prepared to condemn that. Even though it was a terrible war, 50,000 people were killed. Was that the only way to get rid of that particular dictator? I'm not condemning that particular war. However, the new factor now is that even a small civil war could trigger a confrontation between the superpowers so that you get into nuclear war. So that war is more dangerous now than ever before. Consequently, I tend to agree with what Pope John the 23rd said on Easter Sunday in 63 in Parchamentaries. It is inconceivable that war could be a reasonable resolution of a dispute in the modern age.
Do you believe that the just war died with the atomic age?
At least, almost. I'm not prepared to be a pacifist. I am a nuclear pacifist. The Catholic bishops and the bishops all around the world are nuclear pacifists. But that I can't quite categorically say it died, simply because I see oppression everywhere, and I am not prepared to say that the people of the Philippines or the people of Chile can't rise up and have a just war against the aggression against their rights being perpetrated by Marcos and General Pinochet.
You said that there won't be peace in the world, an enduring peace, as long as there are the grossest inequities around the world, poverty, hunger.
No, I agree with that, and that clearly is common sense teaching of the Christian churches and of humanity. The thing, the most important problem in the world, obviously, is this, that in the next 16 years, before the year 2000, 2 billion more human beings are going to come into this earth. The population of the world will go from 4.2 billion to 6.2 billion, and there's nothing can prevent that. Even if we have fantastic contraception and Planned Parenthood, nothing will prevent the population of the earth growing by 2 billion human beings. We have no plan being developed for these people. 85% of these people will live in the third world, and obviously this is going to cause terrible tragedy and catastrophe, and that it may well be that millions of people will say that revolution is our only hope.
Should you project ahead to what you'd like the Congress to have done a decade from now, what action should have been taken?
Oh, well, there's so many things. I don't know where to begin. That clearly they should do something about poverty in this country. In the last 4 years, poverty has grown from 26 million to 35 million, and no one thought we'd ever get back to that. We had a war on poverty. Clearly, we need a tougher enforcement of civil rights. When the Congress enacted the Civil Rights Bill of 64 and the Voting Rights Act of 65, people felt that now this problem is solved. And it was in the process of being solved until the Reagan administration came in and set aside affirmative action, said that we can't deal with quotas, which is a misnomer. No one is for quotas, but goals and targets and timetables. And that we have to really say that the black people are still a separate community in America. And it's two nations, one black and one white. Obviously, on the environmental issues, there has been an enormous setback in the past 4 years. We need to get going with Superfund. We need to say that we are asphyxiating ourselves and, to some extent, the whole world. But obviously, the number one problem is the military. Can we have a military solution to the problems of the world? That seems to be the superstition now, that if we keep increasing the guns that we own, somehow there's going to be peace in the world. And in the 4 years of the Reagan administration, the military budget almost doubled. Unbelievable, up to $300 billion. That is not the solution. We're just terrorizing and intimidating the whole world. What we need is more interfacing with the world, helping the third world to solve their problems. Let me give you a concrete. The World Health Organization said the other day that with a one-time appropriation of $480 million, malaria could be solved forever. This dread disease would just go away, like polio. Why don't we do that? And if we did, we'd be loved by all of the whole world. That's the price of like two or three B1s. So that I think the people in America realize this, hopefully, especially the young people, and that they're frankly crying out for leaders who have the political force to get that program into action.
4 decades ago, the United States was the dominant military force in the United States, and no one could jeopardize our security. What's your assessment 4 decades later?
The questions are getting harder. I like to think that we are more secure, but even that doesn't ring true, because what do you mean by national security? I think that we have intimidated the world. I think more people dislike us now, and they look upon us, and that they say the America is thinking only of its own interests. What we fail to recognize when we get super patriotic, and I distrust patriotism, and super nationalistic, is the fact we're only 5% of all of humanity, Americans. We live as a tiny little group in the global village, and yet we consume almost 50% of the resources, and we dominate the rest of the world, or try to. We should recognize that we're looked to with fear, and that if we wanted to be loved in the decades and centuries ahead, we should say that we're going to live up to our ideals. And our ideals, frankly, are to promote revolution. We shouldn't be on the side of dictators and oligarchies and military governments. We were born in revolution. And that we have the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. We should be exporting those things. And that we were until after World War II, when we get this fantastic fear of communism. And that has just dominated my lifetime. I see all of the aberrations nationally and internationally. And we have to get political leaders who will bring us back to something very sensible, saying we have to get along with the Soviets. We're getting along very well now, if you will, with communist Peking, and that we have their pandas and we love them and we bring their tennis players here. Why can't we have some sensible arrangement with detente with the Soviet Union? People say, oh, but they're out to dominate the world. Sure, they go into Afghanistan and they're not nice to the Polish people. They have faults like we have faults. But it seems to me that the leader who comes along and says we have to have a cessation of this Cold War, because this is leading us to losing our own souls, if you will. To be very Christian about it, we need to have something that is based on love. And if I may quote something that I quoted at the end of my book, Beyond the Nuclear Freeze. A group of Christian clergymen went to the Soviet Union And after they came back, they said this. They denounced the spiral of terror of the arms race, and then they said this, that both superpowers stated that they are seeking our security through arms, and these Christians said, that is, in fact, a false and idolatrous hope. True security can be found only in relationships of trust. These relationships we believe to be possible because Christ has overcome the principalities and powers, quoting Colossians 2:15. And that ultimately they go on and end saying that, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. How many Americans can rise up and have the faith and the courage and the persistence to say, we want to be peacemakers?
Americans want to be peacemakers. What should they do differently?
I have a list of 20 things. They have to fundamentally alter our foreign policy. A baby step to start would be the famous proposal of George Kennan and others that we will renounce first use of nuclear weapons in Europe. We would say that even if the Soviets begin to advance into Western Europe, we will never use nuclear weapons. That means that we have to beef up our conventional forces. NATO has to be stronger. We may need more Americans in Europe. We need more tanks and so on. I think that's a very good, sensible step forward. This is our first line of defense. I don't think anybody will deny that. If we said we're never going to use nukes there, the other side might come forward. We might have a new treaty. That would be the beginning of the de-emphasis, if you will, on nuclear weapons.
Our next step then would be to remove nuclear weapons from Europe.
If we could do that bilaterally, I think it would be a marvelous development. I'm not certain that's possible because, frankly, the paranoia and the suspicions of the USSR are very profound. They feel that we have global dimensions, and they look at us and they say, listen, you have a million or more men all around the world. You have 300 or 400 bases. Why are you encircling the Soviet Union? And we may say, oh, we're not doing that. We're doing that to preserve peace. But we're in the Persian Gulf and we're everywhere. And that they are looking for bases around the world, and that they are particularly troubled at this time as to American intentions, and that when they see us invading Nicaragua and taking over Grenada, they feel that we'd be prepared to do the same thing for them, and that rightly or wrongly, we have to understand that they have this terrible feeling that they are again going to be invaded. In Russia, I couldn't believe it when people were telling me, we have this fear, and we know that the Europeans, once again, just like Napoleon, are going to invade us, and the Chinese are going to invade us.
Two steps in part of your peace plan. One is to renounce the first use of nuclear weapons and to attempt to rely less on nuclear weapons mm-hmm. as part of our national mm-hmm. security. Second step for you is to learn more about the Soviet Union, to understand the roots of their fear of invasion and the sacredness of their national boundaries. What
and
else?
Third, go to the Third World through the United Nations or otherwise, and also to the superpowers and say, we simply have to stop this traffic in conventional weapons. Our country, God help us, leads the pack. And this year we'll be selling $18 billion worth of weapons to any dictator who comes along. This is one of the cottage industries, and it's orchestrated by the Pentagon in the name of our national security. And former generals and colonels and admirals are there making a good buck, helping the third world nations to buy the most sophisticated jets that the Americans can make. The Soviets are second and France is third. This has been the subject of a whole body of literature. It's hideous because those weapons are out there and they're going to be used. And this tells the third world that the solutions to you in Bolivia and Peru and Argentina are more sophisticated armaments. It's totally false. And that it seems to me that Jimmy Carter was absolutely correct when he said, I have to cut back on the sale of arms. The Congress tried to correct this. Now it is the law that no sale of arms over $50 million can go forward without the approval or without the disapproval of if both houses disapprove. They have never been able successfully to utilize that law, and they failed in the Senate with the massive sale of $8.5 billion worth of AWACS to Saudi Arabia. But at least these attempts, that's my third proposition, we have to demilitarize the world, even in conventional weapons.
What else?
Well, I think obviously the problem of hunger is acute, and that this is probably the most agonizing problem. There's 800 million people who are chronically malnourished, every fifth human being. And that's not getting better, despite the efforts of many people. 20 million people die every year, clearly, that we know about. This means that a week from today, 400,000 people will have died of starvation. This is curable. It's doable. We have all of the techniques.
You would allocate that $18 billion for arms sales right away to the hunger problem.
Oh, without doubt, John. And that not merely giving them food, but helping them to cultivate. Some time ago, I was in the Sudan, and I saw an ideal project that the international community could create. They had like 100,000 acres under cultivation of local crops, and the people had built houses for themselves. It was an ideal community, and it was some profit sharing. But we could do that all over the earth. Not that we want to impose our view on the people, but that we want to help them to help themselves.
What's possible with a world rule of law? How do you keep the good parts of nationalism, pride in one's country, one's national character, in our case, the traditions that allow free democracy to work, and yet cooperate better on a world scale, to have a world rule of law that respects nationalism but provides a framework for peaceful resolution of conflict?
Well, we have a lot of things going in that direction. We have the World Court at The Hague, and it's an obscure agency, but they resolve a lot of disputes, frankly, that could otherwise bring about war. That was established just after World War II. Unfortunately, the United States Senate put through the Conley Reservation, which means that we don't go to the World Court unless we agree ahead of time to the jurisdiction. And I think the Reagan administration was outrageous when they withdrew jurisdiction from the World Court concerning any matter in Central America for the next 2 years. And this was a way of avoiding a humiliation at the World Court of The Hague for the United States, because we mined the harbors of Nicaragua contrary to international law.
So a force for peace, in your case, would for all nations to no longer be able to withdraw jurisdiction?
That's right. That's a small lawyer's point, perhaps. But on the larger issues, we have many, many treaties that work quite well. Somehow, the mail is delivered in Moscow from me, and we get their mail, and all planes land safely because we have international standards, and you buy aspirin in the Soviet Union or even in Peking, and it has the same pharmaceutical formula. So we have any number of ways that we can collaborate when it is important to both sides. Well, nuclear arms control is important to both sides. Some people say, but we can't trust the Russians. You can trust the Russians to do what is good for the Russians. And they know that it is very good for them to have bilateral, mutual freeze so that they don't have to spend vast sums of their resources to now have Star Wars where they fear that we'll go. So I think that we should say more communication, and that it's not popular for politicians to say, oh, we have to talk to those Soviets. We like to have enemies, and people are macho, and they say that we can't talk to them, we're going to step on them, we're going to have superiority, and that appeals to people because somehow they feel more nationalistic and patriotic, but that's totally wrong. We have always been friends in the history of America with everybody. Prior to the fall of Peking in 49, we've had a delightful relationship with China. Harvard and Yale and Oberlin and Jesuits went to China and we had universities. It was a beautiful relationship. And all of a sudden, just because they're communists, we terminate all of that. Just as we did wrongly with Cuba. There's no point of just terminating relationships. Go, they think differently, but don't isolate them in the World Committee and force them to go to the other side, as we did Cuba. And we're doing that, I'm afraid, with Nicaragua now, or attempting to do. So it seems to me that we should make the world safe for pluralism and for a diverse group of ideas. Why are we so afraid that somehow they're communists and we're capitalists and that we have to go and fight them? The whole world is one. We're fighting for markets and for influence. Let's go there and be present. One further sub-note on this is that we're rather primitive on languages in the United States. And it seems to me, like in the second grade, we should begin making our kids multilingual.
What would you have the United States and the Soviet Union negotiate first after a freeze? Nuclear weapons are going to be a fact in our lifetimes facing humanity. What actions will lower the risk of nuclear war?
Well, I think that the SALT process was very good, and that I remember the ecstasy that we had in 1972 when Richard Nixon finally signed the SALT treaty banning anti-ballistic missiles. That was a great morality tale in America, because everybody suddenly realized that the ICBMs on the land are very vulnerable, that the Soviets could come and bomb ours, and we could do the same. And they said, well, let's build the anti-ballistic missile. Well, the Congress resisted that, and up in New England, where one of these hideous things was supposed to be, they had a New England town meeting, and they said, you're not going to put the ABM in our backyard. and they had similar meetings all over the country, with the result that the Congress said, we're not going to fund these things, so that Mr. Nixon went to the other side and pleaded and received a commitment from both parties that we're not going to build the anti-ballistic missiles. A fantastic leap forward, and that both sides have observed it. And they formed the Standing Consultative Commission in Vienna so that we know that both sides are observing it. Well, that was a magnificent leap forward. Well, the process continued. And in SALT II, they said that we'll cut back on the number of ballistic missiles, a very complicated arrangement, but we were talking to each other. If we had gone on to SALT V and SALT 15, we would have eventually brought down the a coexistence entirely to something that was manageable.
So for you, arms control represents not only a key part of the national security policy of the United States, but an effective way toward a more peaceful world.
Without doubt, John. And that we talk with each other, and that, you know, we're not enemies of the Soviet Union. We never have been. We love that country. It is a Christian country. There's a lot of Christian elements there now. We love their music, and Tolstoy, and Tchaikovsky, and why are we enemies? Oh, the communists, you can't deal with the communists. You have to deal with the communists. They're there. Furthermore, they're not sweeping around the world, the Soviets. They're not doing very well at all. They got kicked out of out of Egypt and Indonesia. They have virtually nothing in Africa, maybe something in Ethiopia. They have nothing in Latin America except in Cuba. They're not sweeping around the world. They're not a very attractive group. And people aren't going for communism. They want to come to our side. Let us go and help them. And in the United Nations, I'm afraid that we are perceived almost as the enemy of the Third World now. I attended sessions of the General Assembly a couple of years ago, and it was very painful to be an American. And recently I spoke to jurists at Georgetown University from the Third World, 15 or 20 people at a breakfast meeting, and it was hard to be an American because they were challenging our good faith. They were saying that America only wants to dominate and that doesn't want to really listen to the Third World at all. And one man from Bahama left a very, very strong impression on me because he said that we are between the superpowers and that we are all going to get asphyxiated when you people use the nuclear weapons. You never talk to us, you never consult us. You made a commitment that you're going to wipe these things out, and relying on that commitment, these nations in the Third World did not go forward to make the nuclear weapon, and now we are totally vulnerable to the superpowers.
As you project ahead to the world in the year 2000, what hopes do you have for mankind?
Well, I have a lot of hopes because there's a lot of forces and factors working out there. A lot of people are very, very afraid and terrified. The United Nations still exists. The specialized agencies do very well. People are listening to the Holy Father and listening to religious authorities. I like to think that the educators are very aware of what is transpiring, and that I can't predict a total revolution, but that people are ashamed in America of their greed and their materialism. I can't give you a scenario. Here's what's going to happen so that by the year 2000, many of these problems will be resolved. It's quite possible that things will be worse. But that I somehow believe that the moral factors, the spiritual factors are there, and that the United States and the superpowers are going to change their course of thinking.
Father Drinan, thank you for sharing with us today your thoughts on the way to a more peaceful world.